Okay, welcome. My name is Skip Sauls. I'm a product manager here at Salesforce, and with me is Doug Chasman, who's a distinguished engineer. And we're here to talk about Lightning Components. Who here has had a chance to play with Lightning Components at a mini workshop, quick start, etc.? So pretty good show of hands.
Getting better.
If you haven't done that, we'll have some information afterwards. I would encourage you to go play with this. We're going to show you lots of really cool and interesting new things today. And the good news is you can already play with this stuff in your own DE orgs now. So it's ready for you to take, try it out, and see some of the things that we're talking about here. First up, our usual safe harbor statement. And just want to make sure that you understand that what we're talking about here is not meant for purchasing decisions, for immediate development decisions, and that sort of thing. We're going to talk about some things that are in beta and some things that are in pilot. So just keep that in mind. Some of these things are kind of out there a little bit. But most of what you'll see today is actually available to you in your own DE org. So you've heard about Salesforce One Lightning. If you were at the keynote, you obviously saw Lightning Man doing some very cool demos and showing off the drones and so forth. We're going to show you a little bit today that's very similar to that, and it's actually running on the current release. So this is actually live things I'm going to show you. And I'm going to actually go and do a demo first. So instead of starting off with a bunch of slides, let me set the stage by showing you what this thing can do while we're so excited by it. And then we'll come back and go into a little bit of detail about what Lightning Components are. And then Doug is going to tell you all about kind of how we got here, why we built Lightning Components, what they're for, how you can use them, kind of the philosophy behind them, and importantly, some of the things we're doing in the very near future that are also quite exciting. So let me go and mirror my display, because otherwise I cannot do this demo very well. Hopefully that's not too bad a resolution there. So let me bring up a browser, and let me show you a couple of quick things here. So first off, in your Winter 15 org, if you scroll down, you'll see something called the Lightning Components Beta. And this was enabled just a few days ago as part of this Lightning launch. And if you click here, you'll actually see a checkbox. You can turn on Lightning Components. When you turn it on, you can then start building things. This is really a dev environment, so at this point, you're going to be building new components. The goal is to have a lot of you who are customers and partners building some of these components, making them available via AppExchange and so forth, and building a whole ecosystem of these, if you will. So I'm going to show you what you can do with these today. So first off, let's lead with the demonstration of the Lightning App Builder. This is a feature that's currently in pilot, so you won't necessarily see this in your org unless you're enrolled in that pilot. And what's important is to remember that we're showing you what's running currently on the same on the current release. And what you're going to see is actually a Lightning-based application that lets you build new Lightning pages using Lightning components. So in case it's not obvious to you from what you might have heard at the keynote and others, pretty much everything that's UI-related here at Salesforce is now based on Lightning components. And we've been using this technology ourselves internally for nearly 4 years now. If you've been using Salesforce One, you've been using Lightning Components for about a year now. So this is new to you in terms of being made available to you in this beta. But this is, in fact, a well-proven technology, as Doug will describe shortly. So let me create a demo page here. And I want to show you just a couple of things here, and then we'll talk about the components in more detail. So first off, these components that we see here include some that are from Salesforce ourselves. We ship about 5 of those in the current release. We also have a dozen or so components from third parties. We've been in pilot for the past few months with several of our partners. They were using it, building components, and we were able to get them to provide us with package installers to make this cool demo here. So you see components here from Clarisoft, Plumsoft, Squid, and Taz, and that's 4 of our partners who were very actively engaged in the pilot. And you can actually see some of these by clicking. This will load the component. Bring up, for example, the Plumsoft donut chart, which is a very pretty component, very nice to look at. And this can be tied to actual Salesforce data. Part of the features of Lightning Components are that you can actually call into your Apex classes via a controller, so much like you would do from VisualForce. In this case, you're actually going to display it in your Lightning Component-based page, but your backend is largely the same Apex classes, Apex controllers you've been using. Let's also bring in a second component, which is the Taz political map. And this is another one from another third party. So again, what's interesting here is we have third party components playing together nicely in the same page. And we can actually take this and save it and activate it and create a net new page inside of Salesforce One. So save that and activate. And I'll do this as fast as I can, which is basically create this new tab. We'll go to my demo page. Let's just call this demo. And let's pick a nice icon. I like to pick the lightning icon, obviously. And we'll say next and save. And if you're familiar with setup, you'll recognize some of the steps that you may do the same thing with Visual Force and other pages. So mobile navigation. And then I'll move this over and up and save it. No, I don't want to do that right now. And let's go and reload Salesforce One here to cause it to reload that particular page. And I'm running this now in a browser, but you can also view this in the Salesforce One mobile app. And if you're not aware of it, when you're running the mobile app from either iOS or Android, that's actually a hybrid application, which actually is running and hitting the same one.app on the back end. So you're building, when you're building a Lightning component, it's running inside of Salesforce One natively, inside of the container, I should say. So let's look at our demo page right here. We'll see here the donut chart, and we see here also the TAS political map. Now, what's interesting about this, if you're familiar with integrating into Salesforce One previously, is that this is not done via an iframe. So it's not quite the same experience you would get, say, in Visual Force, where you're not really running inside of Salesforce One. You're running as an external window that just happens to be embedded via an iframe. So in this case, we're running in the same DOM. We're sharing the same space. And what's nice about this is we share a lot of the same resources. So we can take advantage of things like the networking optimization we've done for Salesforce One. We can take advantage of things like offline storage and support. So you don't have to write all that yourself in your own application. And importantly, you don't have to make your own connections back and use up extra resources. Very critical mobile device. And also makes things like larger scale devices, tablets and desktops, perform better.
And okay. Even some of the common problems that you run into with an iframed experience that we've all struggled with, things like scrolling is a really common issue, sizing. So some of these, you know, these less technical aspects, but it really impact your user experience. And then we have a lot of capabilities to have you interact with the components here. It's not just these islands that are iframed. You can actually interact with the framework of S1, and components have been built so that you could handle things like navigation events. You can fire navigation events, but you can also handle them really effectively. That's the big game changer here is, unlike what we've done in the past, Salesforce One and then Salesforce One Desktop coming off of that is built from the ground up using the exact same technology that you folks have access to. We've actually not done that in the past. So that's kind of that is one of the big game changers here, is we're using the same technology. You guys are actually not relegated to an iframe silo. So, and a technology silo.
All right, thanks, Doug. So a couple more quick demos. It's great. I've built my own component here using the Lightning component framework to do QR code scanning. And the basic setup is somebody in the field who wants to go out and file an incident report. And instead of having to type in all the values or search for values, they simply scan a QR code you're all familiar with that's maybe printed on the device as a sticker or something. So let me show you a quick little example of that here. We've got a QR lookup. And this same component can be used as a full page tab, effectively, basically taking over the whole tab area, or on that same flexi page we saw before, it dragged and dropped and so forth. So the components can be used together. And I'm going to show you very quickly after this how this component was constructed, kind of what's behind this. There's actually three components at play here, plus a number of events that take place. So let's go ahead and take a photo. And let's bring up this. Everybody always laughs because my face is always peeking out from this.
I can't tell you guys how many versions of this particular photo I've seen over the past few months with Skip peeking out from the corner.
So I don't know if you just saw what happened there, but when that fired, it actually took a picture and it sends it off to a decoder, which is a different component. That thing decodes the QR code, fires another event, which has the QR code string in there, and that gets displayed in that little pop down there, something we call a toast, which I'll try to get with a different record. And in this case, we're just showing it.
Yeah, we see the little QR code there. We should save that one.
Now, the one that's, we'll leave that up there for you. The One that is not checked there is actually lookup record. And that's because these QR codes were printed from my own demo org. It's a different org than we're running from here. But if you have the QR codes for this org and you check that box, it would fire an event and navigate to that particular record home. And that's via basically three lines of JavaScript. Basically, get the event, set the attribute for the ID, fire the event, and boom, there you go. So it's very well integrated into Salesforce One. You can take advantage of a lot of features that are already built into the platform. You're not writing a lot of this yourself. Again, this is very different from the past where we've told you, hey, start off with a blank slate and rebuild everything. Now, to that effect, let me show you one more quick demo, then we'll let the slides back up. If we go to opportunities here, pick an opportunity, and you're probably familiar with this kind of view, except we've added a couple of extra features here. You see the two tabs here across the top that are added on to the usual feed details and related. These are actually extensions, and if you're interested in what I'm about to show you, come to our extension session at 5, but effectively you can add additional tabs which have that same component we saw on the Flexi page. And the tabs actually take attributes which include the record and record ID. You can display this data, do whatever you want to with it, fetch other data from an Apex controller and so forth. And then a snapshot which takes data from the opportunity, from the account, and basically calculates some of these values you see here. So this is added value from a third party. Now to round this out, let's go back to the details view. And you'll see here when you scroll down, an inline, we got a little JavaScript error there, a little drawing bug, but this is the probability drawn as a percentage in a graph as opposed to just a static number. So you can actually override things at the field level. And this is very important for those of you who struggled with this in the past where you said, all I want to do is override one little bit of functionality in the Salesforce page. You've made me go write a brand new, net new VisualForce page to do so. So now we give you a way to override it at a fairly fine-grained level based on things like the object, the field, the layout, the view mode, and so forth. And to make this even more interesting, let's bring up the edit screen.
Yeah.
So one more quick demo. We've overridden an edit field for the amount, and we bring up an alternative keypad. So instead of bringing up the little keypad that slides up and allows you to enter things that way with a normal QWERTY keyboard, you can use this. And importantly, this is going across all the platforms. So this will work on Android, work on Windows, mobile, and so forth. And this gives you a way to basically go in and change that value. And we'll start talking about things like attributes and events and so forth. A key takeaway from this is we're actually modifying a record object being passed into this particular control. We're setting the value for the amount. We're doing a check to say OK, and we click Save. And that actually saves the record from Salesforce One. The component itself doesn't have to do all the work there to update things and save things. It's actually being done by the framework itself.
And the only work that was done there, unlike when you would classically have to do this with VisualForce, as Skip had mentioned, you have to sort of fall off the cliff and re-implement that entire experience, and then you start, because there isn't an equivalent of Apex detail for editing, right? One of the most commonly requested features since we launched VisualForce was Apex Edit, that component that understands layouts but gives you the editing experience. What Skip was showing you was the equivalent of the lightning version of that component that's been asked for years. And not only could I leverage all the layout metadata that I have today, I can surgically, it's literally a very surgical coordinate system we have that lets you say, I want to, where you would normally have the amount field, I want my component there. And it's not, I want an iframe there with a bunch of other things loading, which gives you poor performance characteristics. No matter what you do, the fastest iframe is just not going to load in the level we're expecting. It also has issues with offline. This stuff is fully offline capable because you're doing client-side creation. And that component, which we're not showing that much, other than interacting with, it interacts with the S object, and yeah, it was impacting, which is very cool. That's another major difference here. But you can also interact with the other components that are around you. You can also, there's a whole ecosystem that you're plugging into. When you get really into it, the differences become a lot more transparent. But I like the edit example, because that one shows it really well. The one with the probability, I could do that with an iframe today, right? I might see a little bit more load. Of course, if I turn off my server connection, that component won't work. Mm-hmm. It does work with this component, so an offline mode, which is cool. But the edit is the one that sells it for me. And it's totally surgical. Nobody went, and there's no lightning page behind that. There's just a component and a bit of metadata that we said, put my stuff there and do substitution. And we have a whole range of ways that you can identify this coordinate system I'm talking about is our extension mechanism. You can basically say, replace this other thing, add something here. That's how we added the tabs. And Skip has a session. Actually, one of our partners is doing the session right after this, and it goes into detail about a lot of the extension points.
Okay. So let me just briefly touch on some of the things we just saw, and then we're going to let Doug tell you a bit more about it. And as you can tell, he can tell you lots of things, and we've got a lot of cool stuff to show you. So just briefly here, components in action. What is a component made up of? And in this case, we're actually looking at a number of components. We're going to talk about component composition shortly. Inside of a component, in this case, the camera that we're pointing at, we have the CMP file, the component file itself, which is markup. We have three JavaScript files for controller, helper, and renderer. Then we have the CSS file, the style file, and then a doc file. And as you'll see over time, we're going to add additional features in there as well. So there's more that goes into this, what we call a resource bundle. And this is something that you can use as the deployable unit. So you can actually take this, package it, upload it to AppExchange, install it, and so forth. And when you're working on this, some of these are optional. You'll always have the top level one, but you can add the functionality as needed for controller, helper, renderer, et cetera.
If you want to get a preview of some of those additional features that we currently haven't surfaced through Lightning, you can go to githubforce.com/aura and take a look at the open source image. So we basically have that framework that's out there that's open source for a while, and we have chosen specific areas to expose as we look at the characteristics around versioning and supportability as we bring Lightning out as the cloud-aware version of Aura. So there's definitely, when we put it on top of force.com, there's some considerations we've had to make to go to cloud scale. And the things that we've looked at and said, we're not sure we're quite ready to open that up, you'll be able to see those out there. So you can always get a preview of what's coming if you want to, and we can have conversations on developer.salesforce.com about what's going to be exposed, what's not going to be exposed. There's quite a bit more that we're not currently showing, but most things will actually get exposed through Lightning at some point. We have some bulletproofing to do in a couple places.
All right, so this is showing component composition, and again, we have that top-level component that we saw running. But it's made up of three pieces. The outer shell, which is basically acting as something that has the controls for the events that are going to be fired based upon the QR code. We have the camera, which is actually based on code that I got off of Stack Overflow and just hitting Google and finding tutorials. Then we have the decoder, which actually uses a third-party library. I actually found that again by hitting Google saying, how do I decode these things? So the camera actually is going to interact with the decoder only through events. And the two actually interact with the overall container, the lookup, also through events. To just kind of show this flow, when the user presses the button to take the image, presses the little circle there, it basically wraps the UI press event and tells the camera to take a picture. So the camera takes a picture. The camera basically says, use either WebRTC or use either different mechanisms depending on the device. Takes that image, scales it down, because if you take this really large iPhone-sized image and scale it and try to rotate it and send it off, it can blow mobile Safari up. So it scales it down to a reasonable size, fires this event called add image. The decoder has registered a handler to listen to that. It accepts the image, does all the decoding, and then in turn, if it gets a code out of it, fires the decode event, at which point the overall container can either fire the little toast thing you saw, or it can navigate to the object that maps that particular ID. Now, what's interesting here is if you didn't pick up on it, I didn't write a lot of this net new. This is actually stuff that I found by looking around with other libraries, and it's an important thing to show how open this is. Lightning is not about just Lightning components. It's about Lightning components plus other frameworks, other libraries. Almost anything you can imagine you can do with JavaScript, HTML5, et cetera. Doug, you want to add to that one?
I would say it's not almost, it's anything.
Anything, yeah.
Right. So I will say that the challenges around some of this is working to take this component and make it something that's versionable is probably one of the biggest things, because mm-hmm. the libraries that you're working with, these third-party libraries were not necessarily developed, thinking in terms of I need to be able to support this library without it breaking release over release. So a lot of code that's out there, a lot of JavaScript code that's out there is not version aware. And those are the kind of things when we talk about getting our components to cloud scale, is being able to have components authored by multiple organizations, different individuals across different space and time constraints, and have those continue to work release over release. It's really this, the stuff I'm talking about goes to trust. You know, our core value, number one core value. It's why it's not just let's go use Angular. But you can use Angular. We'll be talking tomorrow and Thursday in a, we have another session on Lightning Futures, where we're gonna be talking about some of the stuff. You can use those frameworks today. We'll be talking also about the kind of research that we're doing in development with in open source with other folks, some are probably in the room, to look at making sure that we have a good story for those third-party libraries. Things like Angular and React are really, those come up a lot. Understanding how to make those work effectively, efficiently, and reliably from a trust perspective year over year with Lightning and with the cloud is the kind of stuff we're doing in those projects. So I'll be asking for help with that also. There's a number of projects around that already spun up. So if you're interested in those types of technologies, definitely want to talk to me. We are looking for people to help try it out, work with us, be committers, the whole deal. Sorry, had to do my pitch.
That's good. So briefly here, what we're showing is you can take that same ID now and actually call an Apex controller. Basically, you get the controller back from your JavaScript side, set the parameters on it, and then you enqueue the action, which means basically fire it, but it puts it into a queue and lets us do some interesting things around optimizing the network bandwidth. And then you'll get back a response back and a callback, at which point you've got an object you can treat just like anything else in JavaScript land. So you get an opportunity, and you can reference it by dot name, dot amount, and so forth. And again, the backend side is Apex, so it's what you're familiar with already. The only real difference is you need to make sure your controller has static methods that have a special annotation at are enabled. But otherwise, it's the exact same Apex you've been writing before. Reuse and repurpose. In this case, we show the same camera component running in the app we saw doing the lookup, as well as in my own little test application, which basically fires events and a list listens to it and shows the images and that sort of thing. So you can take that same component, use it multiple times. Our real intent is to give you something so that you can put it on AppExchange and you can now sell it, share it, whatever you want to think of that as being. And importantly, upgrade and replace those components as needed. So in this case, we took Doug's version of the camera, which is written in Angular, and we're substituting that for the original component. And the cool thing about that is it'll just slot right in. If the attributes don't match up, you can put a wrapper component around it, map the attributes that way. If need be, you can even write init functions on the controller that say basically take something and transform it into the right shape for the next one. So it's all open, extensible. It is for programmatic developers right now. The declarative developers will come into play for things like the Lightning App Builder. So if you're interested in building a component, you need to be a programmatic person who understands some JavaScript and so forth. That being said, we're trying to make it approachable, easy to use, and something that ultimately anybody in Salesforce can use because we'll have this nice tooling layer on top of that.
In addition to the tooling, we have more programmatic technology, some really cool innovations from VisualForce that you first saw come out in VisualForce, like remote objects is a good example. Standard controller, something we've had around for a long time that for a lot of you keeps you from having to go and write Apex. It writes very efficient SQL queries and does all that stuff. We are taking those same technologies, actually the same implementation, and leveraging them inside of Lightning soon. I don't have an ETA yet, but that's stuff that my team's working on right now.
We've already touched on this for packaging, publishing, and installing. And what you'll find is that these components are built for and are on force.com, just as Apex, Visual Force, and so forth. And you can actually create a package, add the Lightning components to it. And the cool thing is we do things like the dependencies. So we'll go off and find the Apex classes and include those in there. You can include your static resources. And if you've installed something and you've built something with tabs and used the components elsewhere and you try to delete that package, we'll warn you, no, you can't do that because it's in use there. That's the kind of thing we need to do to support the enterprise. You don't necessarily get that when you're off in a public cloud where you're kind of doing everything kind of ad hoc and on your own. So we've done a lot of things to make sure that this fits in very nicely with the way that people who use force.com expect it to behave. And then finally, extensions. We've talked about this a lot. We'll show you more about this at the 5 o'clock session if you can make it actually in this same room. And with that, let's talk about the background and roadmap. And I'm going to let Doug cover a lot of this. He's been here since the start and can tell you kind of the history of a lot of this. And this is where things get really fun.
Okay, so some of this I've actually covered, but injecting some comments through the beginning of the talk. Hopefully a lot of you have already heard, done the quick starts, which we saw, and it's a component-based framework for developing dynamic mobile and web applications. That's cool. The really big important thing I already stressed before, but I'm gonna say it again, it's not just for you to build that stuff, it's how we're building our own stuff. This is everything we're doing going forward. And unlike what we did, so when we brought out VisualForce like 6 years ago, we had moderate adoption internally. I don't think the company was feeling the pressure of where our UI was. Today we're feeling the pressure on the desktop. And we went after mobile first, and I think we have a fresh, modern user experience on the web, or sorry, on mobile. We're taking that with Salesforce1 Desktop, which has been talked about in some sessions here, basically taking that same component architecture, in a lot of cases it's the same components, that are responsive and form factor aware, taking them and using them to be our new desktop. The cool thing about that is that same technology is exactly the same stuff you guys are working with when you're using Lightning on top of Force.com. So all of the things that Skip was covering, we're using the same stuff internally. In fact, we've been using it for about two and a half years for serious production level development. And you're actually using stuff on Salesforce today that you probably don't even realize is Lightning based. So it's not just S1. There's a number of other, quite a few other properties within the Salesforce ecosystem that are implemented using Lightning. For folks that have taken the some of the classes we've been giving here, you might be able to figure out which ones those are if you were to view source. So Salesforce build mobile application, yes, it's the engine behind Salesforce One Desktop. It's the tooling that you've been seeing. So folks have seen, Skip mentioned that Lightning App Builder, that is 100% native, 100% Lightning. And based on open source Aura framework, we talked about that. This really, for Salesforce, this was, from a history perspective, this is kind of a big deal. It's one of the first times, we have a lot of open source projects that we contribute to. We've released a lot of open source toolkits. Those have not typically run on our service. They have been things you use from your end, right? They're running, they're accessing Salesforce over clients. There are things where you're running it on S3, Amazon EC2. Or Heroku, of course. And this is a little different. In the case of what you see for Aura out on GitHub, that's the same code base we're running internally. What we end up doing is we have an internal private GitHub installation that's behind our firewalls because of the way that we're structured from a legal standpoint. When we check in at Salesforce, a code change, it is actually nearly instantaneously mirrored out to GitHub. So you're watching us work in the clear out in the open. We also have had a number of contributors outside that take that GitHub image, fork it, and for folks that are used to doing this type of work, it's pretty straightforward, and have actually made changes, made suggestions, fixed bugs in some cases, and have contributed those fixes back through a thing called a pull request. So this is a very different ecosystem where you have the ability to work with us on code that ultimately does run on our service. We have a safety valve, though. It's not like when you can't commit directly to it. It goes through someone like me. But that's pretty a big difference in the way that we're operating here. And fully integrated into Force.com. I would say we are getting there. So some of the things that we've already listed. Standard controller. That is a key staple for Force.com. Right now it works. You can actually instantiate a standard controller yourself, feed it the right set of fields in Apex, and have it do the SQL query generation and return objects. All that works. You can bind to the standard controller. What isn't there is the understanding that we have in VF, where in the VisualForce world, we've got the VisualForce compiler actually extracts all of your field references and nested field references from accounts to contacts and feeds that to the standard controller and tells it, hey, this is what I need. We can leverage the entire standard controller infrastructure, which is bomb-proof and been around with us for a while and very effective. What we are missing is the front end of that that goes through the same type of expression, all those curly bangs that you'll see in markup, and turns that into what standard controller needs in order to understand the metadata that you're trying to go after and the data you're trying to go after. So we're doing things like that. The biggest part of this, is there another, On the other slide, yeah. Where's my components? Yeah, this one. Beta, yeah, we've been happy about this because this was a big deal. To go from pilot and a very small controlled pilot, I'm extremely excited about seeing this beta and getting it out there. Obviously, a big push for us is going to be getting to GA as fast as we can. But what's missing and what's coming up? We have hundreds of components. I think the count is currently over 800, plus hundreds of events. Everything in Salesforce One plus all these other properties. I think Parker in the keynote just said, you know, that's all available right there. When you go to look in your D org and you're starting to play with the beta, you're going to see a very short list of components coming from Salesforce right now. The number one thing that we're working on is getting these components that we've been using internally that are really good. I mean, these are like the feed component we have is fantastic. And you would not believe how expensive and difficult. That feed is a full-featured application on its own. It's more complicated to solve that problem. I mean, if you think about it, it's a big part of what Facebook is from a UI perspective, is just that one component. We have that. It's ready to go, and I'm working with the feed team to get them to go into their component and mark it as global so that you guys can have access to it. It's that easy for us to expose a component. The reason that we haven't done that is that's a contract with all of you for all time, and that is something that we don't take lightly. We're looking at all of these components from a different lens now that says, all right, are we ready? Are we comfortable putting this out there? Because once we give it to folks, it's there forever. We have the ability to migrate it and change it over time, but that's not the same thing as keeping it internal and just using it for ourselves. So a lot of what we're doing now is getting that set out to you. I mean, it's more components than you could want. And this is something that's really important to me because the components are there. The only problem I have is getting them out to you. That's a good problem to have. It's different than when people are launching a framework and saying, well, we'll have some great components. We have them. They're there. You will see them showing up shortly. Performance. For folks that are, you know, the JavaScript jocks in the room, if you start to do some reverse engineering and playing with how this stuff runs in your browser, you're going to be underwhelmed in a lot of cases. I've actually got a whole bunch of folks in the room. I got these guys right here in the front row that are on the project, Lightning Halo project, or we've just been calling it Halo. That is reworking our client-side runtime. It doesn't change the code that you author. It just makes your components run better. It's our internal plumbing for how we take the component that you've created, how we actually make it run. So there's an engine that runs in JavaScript. That is being reworked in a heavy, heavy way to get significant, are we orders of magnitude? Yeah, Diego says orders of magnitude. So you agree, Chris? Okay, I got two shaking heads from these are basically the leads of this project, and they're shaking their heads and saying, yeah, orders
nodding,
of magnitude.
They're nodding their heads, positive.
Nodding. Positive, sorry, not, oh yeah, sorry, wrong gesture. So this is what they're focused on. We've actually started that work. We've been working on that for about eight months now, I think, total, but spun even more resources as we realized that we really needed to work on this. So don't judge us by the way it looks right now. Judge us, actually, this will be mirrored out to open source shortly. Safe harbor, but it's weeks, couple of weeks. So you can see what, and it'll take a little bit longer for it to hit all of you on force.com, but if you want to see what we're talking about and the changes, I love the fact that we have this open source that's a continuous stream. You are really seeing the next release for us. Okay, and integration of third-party frameworks. That is a topic that's very near and dear to my heart. I want to make sure we have time for questions, though. But I did mention, we talked a little bit about some of the stuff that Skip's already worked with the QR decoder and everything. A lot of the partners that I've worked with are, and ISVs that have been in the pilot program, wanted to use Angular, or they wanted to use jQuery, or they wanted to use jQuery UI, jQuery Mobile, and some other frameworks in there, but Angular being the biggie for whatever reason. It's just a small cross-section. But we're also looking at React and the laundry list of the top six or seven to take a serious look at, you can use them all. I've used them all with Lightning very effectively. But there are a common set of pitfalls and challenges around taking two frameworks that have a fair amount of opinion and bringing them together. So taking Angular and Lightning and pushing them together can actually be quite horrid at the beginning of trying to get them to spin up and actually just work because their life cycles are different. We're working with small groups of people, both internally and externally, to build what I've been calling lightning packs. They're similar to our mobile, same concept as our mobile SDK packs, which I thought was a brilliant idea. Instead of having everybody out there giving, you know, we give you the mobile SDK and you can build hybrid apps and then go do it. The problem is everybody was trying to solve the same thing.
We'll probably get to Q&A. Oh,
okay, sorry. So we're trying to package that up into a set of best practices, set of software that you don't have to solve that every time. You can use those libraries today. Okay, with that Q&A?
Yes, and if you'd like to ask a question, there's a microphone here that...
Is there only one?
I think so. I think it's in the center here.
So please come to the center. Can you go to the mic, please? Sorry.
And the next session is at 5, actually in the same room with me doing it, so we can stay a little bit longer if you guys want. It ends at 4:40 officially, but we'll be here answering questions, so feel free to stay and ask those as well, even if they shut down the lights and video.
So I have a question. Can we use this lightning components that are developed on a single page? We have more than one component, and can they talk to each other?
Definitely. So a big part of, one of the things I think Skip showed on one of his slides was all these events flying around. The mechanism for components to talk to each other is basically events and attributes. So components can set attribute values on other components. That's part of their public signature. Mm-hmm. But a big way that they tend to communicate, and it depends on the problem, is event-based. And events can either be component-to-component, sort of a point-to-point communication, or a broadcast and pub-sub type of a communication. We have different policies and different patterns that you can combine events with other components. And S1 has a whole set of events that it uses that you can hook into, like navigation events when somebody opens an S object. If you wanted to build something that understands that and slaves and reacts to it, that's actually very straightforward. And events are, they're part of the public API that we're releasing. And they're part of, if you're releasing your own stuff, it's part of that API. So the surface area for a component, it's public API, it's attributes, that's its shape, and the events, which events have shape also. At some point we'll be releasing theming, CSS, basically the same kind of treat styling as an API. That's not quite there yet, but that's, when we talk about the API surface area, that's the stuff you can count on that isn't going to change. If you try and poke into the JavaScript for a component, if you try and look at the styles and leverage that, you know, your mileage is going to vary.
Okay. The other question I had with respect to this is when you have multiple components on the same page and they are editable, and when you're trying to submit the form, can these two components get submitted at the same time, you know? When I say if you plug in a different component like Salesforce, if you just created some JavaScript-based component and using iframe and you submit it, you will have to submit one piece at a time most of the time. Right?
Oh, no, this all goes together.
So
in fact,
this can all go to serve together. And this has to be static method, I guess, in the controller. I guess you mentioned that.
In a lot of cases, you might actually just be impacting the JavaScript representation of an S object, for example. And there's one action that just sends the whole thing. If you were doing maybe an inline editing scenario, that you can also, it's when you decide to go to the server, is stuff we can talk more about the different patterns. The thing is, it's sort of, yes. You can have that. We don't have these islands anymore.
Yeah.
But you have an amazing amount of expressiveness, which also makes it hard to answer the question with a just, here's how you do it. I need to know more about exactly the experience you want.
Okay. We can discuss something.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks.
More for probably the declarative admins, but one confirming this, the builder will probably be part of standard licensing, yes?
That's a question for your sales rep.
We're
not supposed to talk licensing and pricing and so forth. Sorry.
Do you have plans to roll it out to standard pages, page layouts, not just for Salesforce One?
Just in the mobile, you mean?
Right.
Again, we talk about future Salesforce UIs all being based on Lightning components. Mm-hmm. Read between the lines. I'm trying to talk around things. We're not necessarily, some things got announced, but...
Right.
I think they announced the desktop in March.
Salesforce
session.
One,
yeah.
The desktop.
So yeah, the next generation of all of our UIs is all based on Lightning components.
So do you have a timeline?
I do not.
No.
I can safe harbor on that. Sorry. Yeah.
I can tell you that we're tooling up a huge amount of resource. It's not like a few people in a garage somewhere. It is a significant amount of R&D, and that project is being led directly by Parker Harris. He's sitting with that team every day. So it's with the suit. I forgot. Yeah, I can talk about the suit now. Yeah, with the suit. Hey, Wes, hopefully he doesn't wear the suit for the duration of the project, or at least it can. Maybe he's got two of them, so he can launder it in between days, because it gets kind of close in there.
Okay, I just got like two questions. It's like, first is, are the apps you build on the Lightning App Builder available as a metadata, so that you can, for like deployment purposes or like source code control? And then second, what happens to like your existing Visual Force pages when Lightning rolls onto desktop? Will the world fall over and we have to change things?
No, Visual Force is with us for the long haul.
Okay.
Where we are putting our future dollars is in Lightning. But the Visual Force team and the Lightning on the platform, this is the team I work on. We have Lightning framework, we have Lightning components, we have tons of teams building Lightning components and apps within our application groups. And then we have the group that I'm in, which is our sole job is to take Lightning and make it work really well with Force.com. We also own Visual Force.
Okay.
So what I'm really excited about with that is I got a whole group of people that know what it means to live and breathe Force.com. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the things that was missing in the balance of Lightning. We have a lot of people on Lightning that really understand the framework and understand how to build great components, but haven't had a lot of real world experience of rolling us out to Force.com. That's invaluable to me. So, and we have actually beefed up the support staff for Visual Force also. So some of the folks that are going to be helping with Lightning, with that background, we've also backfilled them with additional resources.
So this sort of like go hand in hand.
And we're taking a lot of the concepts, the really cool implementations. Remote objects, I think, is a great thing. Mm-hmm. That technology rolled out in Visual Force very recently. That implementation is moving on to Lightning also. So that programming model will be identical or very near identical. It's just Lightning components to define your relationship, the things that you want to get from the server. I want to go after accounts. The JavaScript object model and API for remote objects, this is the same one.
Okay.
The one thing we're going to do differently, give you an idea of where it's not just ported, is Skip had mentioned that we've done stuff for managing connectivity and really dealing with the low latency or high latency connections and spotty connections down at the very low transport layers of Lightning. It does some really smart things to try and take all this chattiness and put it into one XHR, send it to the server, send it back. We're going to take that that transport layer and plug it into remote objects. So remote object requests will also participate in that, what we call boxcarring, which also gives us the ability to talk about offline and storage service, some other pieces that you'll see rolling out that gives us a lot of our part of our performance story. To give you the immediate, we can actually satisfy common read-only requests or read requests as you're navigating through an app. It's very simple for you to set it up so that those are satisfied client-side. So imagine remote objects realizing, hey, you're going to get a list of accounts. I've already gone and got that list of accounts because you just navved there a few seconds ago. I'm going to show you that list, and then I'll go get the list current. I'll get the current version of the list, compare it to what I just gave you. If it's the same, it never happened. No server trip. So you show the last known good, do that round trip. This is all sort of immediate performance capabilities. It's you need the server, but you don't want that round trip. Does that make sense?
Yep.
VF's not going anywhere. Oh, sure. We've got to keep it. That's part of our trust contract.
Ask us about design files offline. We'll tell you more about the question about the Lightning App Builder you were questioning.
And that metadata will be packageable. The stuff that comes out of App Builder, metadata API, everything we do is API first. So we can't release a feature without metadata API support and tooling API and other stuff like that. Yeah, that's just sort of the basic bar for what we do. I always forget to tell people that, but yeah.
Okay.
Great,
cool.
Thanks. Yes, sir.
Cool. Thank you for the presentation. You mentioned 800 components that you have internally built already. And so the question, or maybe even a request, is as developers, is there going to be some type of a list of components that we know you've already built so that we have the confidence going forward to be able to build our own?
There's no reason we can't release that list, right?
We need to figure out how to the pre-release list to publish it.
Yeah, because we're actually looking also at a phased rollout. So one of the things we're going to be adding capability, it's a very straightforward feature for us. We've been talking about, after interacting with a lot of people here, we realize there's a lot of benefit to doing a pilot on a component level. basis. We've done that kind of stuff internally and all that, but actually being able to give all of you access to something, there's no reason for it to be, we don't have to release a whole nother version of Lightning to give you a bunch of components. We can actually roll individual components out through their own life cycle. So I think, I like the idea though of, we could probably even release the prioritized safe harbor prioritized list. Not all of those components are gonna be released. Some of them are very purpose specific, but the top 100.
Yeah, easily.
We have 100, I think, that should be released immediately.
So kind of similar, as a manager of developers, which is my role, you talk a little bit about the kind of seeing the ecosystem go forward. So are you envisioning that it's going to be kind of a market that's, rather than, say, full app exchange where it's full product releases, you may actually have software companies that what they do is the release of the components, and that's what they do to maintain it with the releases, similar to like a Infragistrix or a DevExpress or Telerik guys?
Exactly. So we envision people building base level components that do better UI, you know, better sliders, better date pickers, better input fields, things that are very specific to a particular industry, you know, that are very granular. So again, that fine-grained extension model lets you do that. And you can even offer those on AppExchange as, you know, one particular component you install and you buy at a you know, at some price, or free. Then also that will support going up to the app-based things, which are the tabs, the full-blown things. And what we haven't discussed is you can build full-blown or Lightning applications that actually have a URL addressable endpoint, a .app, which is the same thing one .app is, and put all your Lightning components inside that. So it's not limited to just being inside of Salesforce. It's a right. full-blown environment for building whatever you'd like. But all the same components will work in all those environments as well.
Well, that was similar to the second part of the question, which was, what is the level of complexity that, you know, a developer shop can create with something like that control, whether it's, you know, something simple or...
Infinite complexity, because, again, we have a partner who's built a full-blown app for ERP. Plumsoft is actually building their entire app. It's a standalone app, runs totally outside of the Salesforce UI, both even the modern desktop. It's full-blown. They've used things like Bootstrap, jQuery, and various libraries. Very pretty application, and those same components.
Can you show it?
I can't show it. I'll have it installed here.
Okay.
But those same exact components can be used inside of Salesforce1 and in future UIs as well.
Okay. I guess the last thing, because I know there's a lot of people who have the same interest that I do, is where would you guys like us to meet with you as far as those of us that are interested in participating and helping you guys with the eval process, as you mentioned?
So there's a couple different mechanisms. One is the forums that are on developer.salesforce.com. And then also we run, as we mentioned, things like pilots. And if you're interested in being some of these pilots where you get access to things beforehand, talk to your SE, TSE, basically your Salesforce reps. They can actually file a request. For things like extensions, that pilot needs somebody who's fairly technical, because right now we don't have a pretty drag and drop tool for it.
Sure.
But that being said, our partners took our samples and built these extensions very rapidly. In fact, some of them were turning it around in like 15 minutes, building the extensions, plugging into S1. So it's not hard. But it's not for the type of, if you need to know XML, JavaScript,
it's
and that
not
kind
point
of thing.
And click, but it's yeah. it's not rocket science either. It's
Excellent.
Pretty straightforward.
But our ISVs are having a good time with this. They've built stuff that are made. In fact, we've said we don't need to build any demos anymore because the ISVs are doing all the work for us.
No, and I think my guys will like it too. So great job, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks.
Hi.
It's kind of a philosophy question. I've been spending the past 2 years sitting in a cave building a drag and drop CPQ admin. We have everything in one giant monster JS file, and it keeps growing. But because of JavaScript remoting, it's fairly compartmentalized. Would you suggest each one of the portions of that code going into a component and then having them talk to each other, or is that...
Yes, actually. Okay. So the... Have you come end up with that architecture of having sort of a single monolithic file? Is there a reason you did that? Like, are you trying in order to get like one file that could be downloaded by the browser?
Partly, okay. And because
I have good news for that. If that's part of the story,
yeah,
you get to build in a componentized world where you can manage the complexity, and you have primitives, object-oriented primitives, that are very similar to what you're used to using in other languages, right? You can have effectively procedures or methods or functions. And you can decompose your code and decompose your application to the grain that you want, that makes sense, so it's maintainable and reusable.
Right.
But at runtime, we assemble all that together into a single app.js file, single app.css file that's basically lexically ordered properly, so dependencies are managed and satisfied. We run that through Google Closure minification and compression, and do all the best practices for you. So you get a single file. On top of that, with a single attribute on your app, you can say use app cache, which basically kicks in auto support for HTML5 application caching, which right. gives you a single round trip for all of your client-side cache coherency checks. So not a whole bunch of 304s anymore going up. You pay one round trip, it goes and gets a manifest, the manifest comes down, the browser locally does that the coherency checks. That actually makes a big difference on initial startup.
I'm ready to go.
Think about an ISV model. If the distribution mechanism for Lightning components is going to be packages, and if we want to build our own apps in packages, does that mean we're going to be able to put packages in packages or dependencies that might be deal with that? Like, how's that going to work?
Our teams are not currently augmenting the packaging infrastructure, but there are some very smart people, including our CTO, Stephen Tam, who is personally involved in looking at our next generation packaging sort of application lifecycle management. I have no time frame from that. I've just seen some really, really compelling documents coming from him and some things he's been doing on his own time also. He's very passionate about this.
I wanted to know about cross-domain.
We have to clear the room now.
Yeah.
For the
why don't we take it? Let's take it outside.
For those interested in the extensions, we'll be talking about that in about 10 minutes. And thank you very much for attending.